Good morning, First Church family. I'm Elena Wissey.
And I'm Brett Wissey, and we want to welcome you to First Church this morning, a place where all are welcome to worship, grow, and serve.
Whether you're worshiping with us this morning virtually or in person, we are so glad that you are here.
Good morning. My name is Tiffany Dowding. I'm the Minister of Youth and Social Justice Engagement here at First Church. This morning, I have a few announcements I would love to share with you about things that are happening in the life of the church. Our first announcement is actually happening this afternoon. This afternoon, we are hosting our pop-up picnic at Railroad Park. And so around noon, we invite you to bring your lunch and enjoy a wonderful, beautiful afternoon that will be socially distanced. We'll have some games for the children and youth and those of you who are young at heart, but our church will also be providing Still City Pops. So if that's something that you feel comfortable with and you're interested in, we invite you to join us this afternoon around noon at Railroad Park. Later on this month, we will also have an opportunity for us to join together outside and support our Birmingham Legions. If you enjoy soccer like I do, or you are just ready to be outside with some people, we invite you to join us for a game. We'll be selling a limited number of tickets on our website, and so you can go to firstchurchbhm.com and go to the Coming Up tab, and there you will find our Birmingham Legions game. There you can also reserve your tickets, and this is giving us an opportunity to sit together and to go to the game together as a group. So our last announcement is about our Justice and Mercy ministry. On May 6th, which is a Thursday, at 6 p.m., we will be hosting a Faith in Action Alabama information meeting. So this meeting will be on Zoom, and this is a way for us as a congregation and individuals to learn more about what it is that Faith in Action Alabama is doing, specifically here in our Birmingham chapter. A few of the things that they are focusing on is gun violence and anti-racism work. They do some really wonderful things, and this is an opportunity for us as a congregation just to listen, ask questions, and learn a little bit more about how we can be engaged in our community. So if you're interested in learning more about Faith in Action Alabama, or you want to attend the meeting, or if you have questions about Justice and Mercy Ministries, please email me directly. My email is tiffany@firstchurchbhm.com, and just send that to me and I will send you the link and answer any questions that you might have. So we are so excited that you are here today. That's all of our announcements. Please greet each other in the comments section below. Welcome one another, share this video. Don't forget to like it. Also, if you have prayer requests, please feel free to share those in the comments. Our staff and our pastors are in the comment section with you, and we look over all these, and we want to hear from you. We want to hear what it is that's on your heart and what it is that you need prayer for. So thank you for being a part of this service today. Don't forget, you also have access to our virtual bulletin, so you can follow along. You can find that in the comment section of this video, or you can find it on our website under worship. Now, let us take a deep breath and take a moment to prepare our hearts as we continue to worship together.
Thank you. My name is Katie Gilbert, and I serve as our executive pastor. This morning, I invite you to hear these words from John chapter 21. Jesus later appeared to his disciples along the shore of Lake Tiberias. Simon Peter, Thomas the twin, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, and the brothers, James and John, were there. Together with the two other disciples, Simon Peter said, "I'm going fishing." The other said, "We will go with you." And they went out to their boat. But they didn't catch a thing that night. Early the next morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not recognize who he was. Jesus shouted, "Friends, have you caught anything?" "No," they answered. So he told them, "Let your net down on the right side of your boat, and you will catch some fish." They did, and the net was so full of fish that they could not even drag it up into the boat. Jesus' favorite disciple, Peter, "It's the Lord." When Simon heard that it was the Lord, he put on the clothes that he had taken off while he was working. Then he jumped into the water, and the boat was only about 100 yards from the shore, so that other disciples stayed in the boat and dragged in the net full of fish. When the disciples got out of the boat, they saw some of the bread and a charcoal fire with fish on it. Jesus told his disciples, "Bring some of the fish you just caught." Simon Peter got back into the boat and dragged the net to shore. In it were 153 large fish, but still the net did not rip. Jesus said, "Come and eat." But none of the disciples dared ask who he was. They knew he was the Lord. Jesus took the bread in his hands and gave it to some of the disciples to eat. He did the same with the fish. And this was the third time that Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. I invite you now to join me in prayer. God of the seed and soil, we give thanks for the rich diversity of food to eat in our world, for the grains that become bread, for the fruits that move us through the seasons, for the vegetables we can grow in our backyards, for the nuts tenderly nurtured and dropped by the trees, for eggs lovingly laid by chickens, and so very much more. God, who demonstrates the power of friendship, in a year that has forced us away from one another, we long for the days we can gather again to eat with the ones we hold most dear. We carry gratitude for the times we have spent sharing stories and laughter around the table, for bellies filled with good food, for love shared through time spent in the kitchen, and for conversations carried on while cleaning dishes. We give thanks for the people who make our feasts better. Help us never to take for granted the opportunity to eat with one another. And God of table fellowship, we recognize that not everyone has felt welcome. Not everyone has been nourished. Not everyone has had a seat at the table. We grieve the ways that food has been used as a tool to exclude, the ways that food has not been made accessible to everyone as it should, the ways that a table has been used to push people away. Forgive us for our part in the systems that exclude and perpetuate harm against your beloved children. Give us the strength and wisdom to find ways to shift and change systems so that all might have good food to eat and a welcome spot at the table. And God, just as you taught us to pray, we join our voices together this morning to say, Our Father, Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Ooh.
Good morning. As we move in worship, I invite you all to hear our second scripture reading from Ecclesiastes chapter 3. There's an opportune time to do things, a right time for everything on earth, a right time for birth and another for death, a right time to plant and another to reap. A right time to kill and another to heal, a right time to destroy and another to construct. A right time to cry and another to laugh. A right time to lament and another to cheer. A right time to make love and another to abstain. A right time to embrace and another to part. A right time to search and another to count your losses. A right time to hold on and another to let go. A right time to rip out and another to mend. A right time to shut up and another to speak up. A right time to love and another to hate. A right time to wage war and another to make peace. But in the end, does it really make a difference what anyone does? I had a good look at what God has given us to do. Busy work, mostly. True, God made everything beautiful in itself and in its time. But God left unused the dark, so we can never know what God is up to and whether God's coming or going. I've decided that there's nothing better to do than go ahead and have a good time and get the most we can out of this life. That's it. Eat, drink, and make the most of your job. It's God's gift. Amen. As we move in worship this morning into a time of giving, I just want to invite you all to continue to be generous and know that things like today and our churchwide picnic at Railroad Park, put on by our fun team, in which we'll all get Still City Pops if you show up before we run out, it is through your generosity that we're able to have events like our churchwide picnic. And it is at events like that that we tell people that you are all welcome here. You are all included in this faith community. And that is one way we live out our priority of being hospitable. And so events like today are important because we, the church, we, the body of Christ, are created to love each other and to have fun. And today we get to do that outside safely at Railroad Park. So I hope to see you there. And now let us move and give generously as God has given generously to each of us.
not sure who you really are. When all you feel is the shape of your scars, and you have more wounds than you can count. Open your eyes, look all around. You aren't alone. This is your
Good morning. Today we begin a new sermon series, one called Good Company. It's a series that we hope will help us become more fully aware of life and its inherent pleasures and joy. You see, we all know that we have spent a year or more with very limited ways of experiencing pleasure, having fun, and sharing in the good company of other people. This has forever changed us and probably shaped us in ways that we aren't even likely aware of yet. Yet, as our community begins to reemerge from this time of separation and this hardship, we want to hold up the ways in which our faith affirms that we are meant to enjoy life, have fun, and celebrate together. We will do so by exploring in our series called Good Company the themes of eating, playing, laughing, and dancing. However, before we dive into our theme today of eating, I want to name something that is hard, but it's true. Our relationship with food and eating is complicated as a society. For many people, food is a pleasure. It's abundant, it's varied, and we eat it because we like the taste and we have lots of options. Yet that's not true for all of the world. It's not even true for everyone who's listening to the sermon. For some, food is scarce, and it's not eaten to be enjoyed, but out of deep hunger. likewise. For others, food may not be pleasurable. There are many, whether we know it or not, who struggle with disordered thinking and eating behaviors. Food for them is scary. Mealtimes are stressful and fear-inducing. Some turn to symptoms to numb the feelings that are held deep within their bodies in order to experience relief. I imagine for those individuals, this sermon topic may feel scary and painful because they didn't come to church to have someone talk to them about food. They don't feel good in their bodies, and they're scared this will always be that way. I imagine just me naming this evokes feelings of fear because you don't want anyone to know. Again, you didn't come here to hear this from me. And because disordered eating has a way of making us feel ashamed of the struggles we're going through. I'm really, truly sorry. I don't ever want anyone to feel more in pain or to feel alone in their struggles. I understand that these issues with food can be incredibly hard. And I want you to know that if you need a safe place for someone to listen, I would be glad to be that. I also have several resources of trusted clinicians who specialize in journeying with persons experiencing eating disorders as they help them move towards wholeness. There is help and recovery is possible, and I and our community want to support you. Okay, having said that, today I'm going to try my very best to talk about food and the ways in which I believe it is intended to be a source of life for our bodies, for our souls, for our relationships, and for our community. Ecclesiastes is an interesting little book. It's full of life lessons and everyday wisdom. We aren't really sure who wrote this piece of wisdom literature, but it's often assumed that Solomon is the author or the pseudo-author. Zondervan Academic says the purpose and the message of the book is to convey, there is nothing under the sun that is capable of giving meaning to life. Nice. Even if some level of fulfillment and self-satisfaction were achieved, death is waiting at the end. Ouch. Frustration and adversity are unavoidable, and answers to hard questions of life are not forthcoming. Thanks a lot. However, they say, while the pleasures of life are not intrinsically fulfilling and cannot offer lasting satisfaction, they can be enjoyed as gifts from God. Now, some would say this book is just a touch cynical. Others might say it's a dose of reality. It's looking life straight in the face and naming it for what it is. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want promises that don't come true. And I don't want someone to just say something to make me feel better. I want the truth. I feel like Ecclesiastes tries to offer that to us. In it, it shares that, yep, life is hard. Unfortunately, no matter how much we want it to be so, there is at times no rhyme or reason for why things go from good to bad. Now, I know some people need to believe that God does certain things and has a greater purpose in our struggle and our pain. But this book seems to affirm that in many ways, struggle is just the nature of life. But it also seems to provide space to let God off the hook for all the devastating things that happen. I mean, maybe it isn't God's will. Maybe God is the creator of life, but has released any idea of control and lets life just happen. Part of the gift of this book is to invite us to take joy, satisfaction, and pleasure where we can, because we know these things will come and go. The author invites us to see these moments as gifts from God. And among those gifts, the author names eating. Eating, at its best, should make us full inside and out. Full with nutritious food that spurs our body to wholeness, and full of joy, laughter, friendship, and forgiveness that spurs our relationships and our emotional and spiritual body towards wholeness as well. There are countless texts revolving around eating that help us form our understanding of the gift of food and the experience of breaking bread with others. Take the Passover meal, for example. The Hebrews' experience of fleeing Egypt and gaining their freedom was wrought with life as explained in Ecclesiastes. It had good and bad. Terrible events transpired that led Pharaoh to let the Hebrew people go into their freedom. But in the midst of the death and the pain, God instructed them to share a meal together, to remember. To remember their freedom, to remember God's presence in the midst of pain, to remind themselves that God is about liberating those who are bound. Even today, this is a sacred meal for Jews who remember together the gift of life as they eat food that symbolically reminds them of their story. A leg of lamb, bitter herbs, and bread dipped in salt water. We find Jesus in the New Testament beginning his ministry with a miraculous turning of water into wine at a wedding. Now, I know that that is wine and not bread, but both would have been present at that wedding feast. This feast would have lasted days, and for the working poor, wedding feasts provided necessary bridges in food distribution gaps. You see, people came to weddings to eat and to drink, and they may not have had all that they needed at home, and so this was a respite for them. Jesus providing for this meal was celebratory, gracious, and miraculous. It was also correcting an inherent wrong within the culture. It was providing the nourishment their bodies needed while also providing them the chance to celebrate and be relieved from the stress of everyday lives that they carried around in their body and their soul. The final biblical example I want to share is one of my favorites, and that is of the resurrected Jesus breaking bread and having a fish fry with his disciples on the beach. Now, I will never fail to tell people that this proves Jesus affirms our desire to go to the beach or to the lake and to have a good time. But in seriousness, it was this breaking of the bread and the sharing of the fish that these disciples recognized Christ and each other's true nature once again. They were reunited in their purpose, and for Peter, he was reinstated as the rock for the future church. After the meal, Jesus and Peter have the most intimate exchange about love and nurturing Jesus's flock. There's a picture on the cover of our bulletin of a sculpture that is there. Three times Peter is given the chance to correct his denial of Jesus. Jesus graciously allows Peter to restore what was broken, and all this forgiveness was captured around the campfire with food. At its best, eating literally keeps our bodies alive. It has the power to keep our souls invigorated with hope and grace. It potentially binds people together in trusting friendships and allows them the space and the time to ask for forgiveness and to restore what may have been broken. There is power in eating in good company. Unfortunately, this good gift has been absent for much of this past year for us. We have eaten alone or only with our families. We have at times eaten poorly as we struggled to go to the grocery store and get what we need, or we may not have had access. We've experienced fear associated with eating as we haven't felt it's been safe to eat inside a building with others or with those outside of our bubble. I would bet at some point we have all turned to food for emotional comfort. Or we've been so distraught or stressed out that we chose not to eat even when our body was telling us we were hungry. I say all this to remind you that we are not alone in our struggles. I have eaten when I've been mad, sad. I have turned to wine, sugar, chips, and popcorn when what I needed was to be able to turn to a friend, to feel a warm hug and experience what Steel Magnolias reminds us, that laughter through tears can be a favorite emotion. But this past year has taken much of that from us. My friends, in some way, we have all inherited some measure of disordered thought about eating during this pandemic. We didn't really have a choice. This pandemic has done its best to alter our relationship with food. But where we have been, and maybe even where we are, is not where we will stay. Hear me say this. We, you, have made the best decisions that we could with what we were dealt with and what we knew at the time. We may look back and say we could have done something differently with hindsight, but I don't think we will be able to look back and say, you know, we could have tried harder to make wise and faithful decisions. We have done the best we could. Today's invitation is to begin to release our tightly wound fists on the grip of this roller coaster of a year and to extend a warm hand in a friendly wave, or if you're ready, a handshake or a hug to another. To begin to take back the gift given to us in the good company of others, the gift that is meant to be given to all the earth in eating together and finding our bodies and our souls nourished and restored. It may be scary. There will still likely be necessary modifications, but it's time we begin to celebrate this life together again. It's the only one we will get, and it is one that is best savored with good company around the table. So I hope you'll take the time to join me this afternoon at Railroad Park, where you're invited to join our church family in an outdoor picnic. And remember, there will be Steel City Pops on the church available for everyone. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Pam Crider. Please meditate on these words as I repeat the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Diversity of humanity, you declared us very good as we were made in your image, born of the soil of Africa. Our beginnings are rooted in the dark, sun-soaked skin tones of other continents, and therefore we recognize all of humanity are your children equally. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name as we join their unending hymn.
Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna. always longed for us to turn from violence and towards love. When brother turned against brother and Cain killed Abel, you saw the jealousy that was rooted in fear. You heard Cain ask, "Am I my brother's keeper?" And we hear you cry to us, "Yes, you are all your siblings' keepers." Therefore, we know that we must act swiftly when our siblings cry out for help, saying that they can't breathe because they are face down with the knee of authority pressed against their neck. We must respond when we hear her say that she is fearful of being at home for the harm that may come from the hands of one who should love her. We must not sit silent when there are words of hate are slung about any one person or group of people. We must work to heal our racism, our sexism, our xenophobia, our homophobia, and classism in this world. Otherwise, we remain enslaved to fear and violence. When your people cried out in slavery all those years ago, you heard them. You did not ignore their suffering. You raised up leaders who would speak truth to power, and you led your people into freedom. Through the prophets, you tell us what you long for in our worship is for us to loose the bonds of injustice and to let the oppressed go free. Grant us courage to answer that call. Guide us towards justice and freedom for all. In great love, you sent to us your Son, Jesus. Born in poverty, living under the rule of a foreign empire, brown-skinned, dark-haired, Middle Eastern, they called him Yeshua, your Son, Jesus, who welcomed the unwelcome, accepted the unacceptable, the foreigners, the radicals, the illiterate, the poor, the agents of the empire, and the ones who sought to overthrow it, the men and the women who were deemed unclean because of their maladies. They were all your children, as we are all your children, because you have taught us in Christ that there is no Jew or Greek, there is no slave or free, there is no male or female. In Christ, we are all one. Black, brown, white, female, non-binary, male, citizen, and immigrant. In Christ, we are all one. So, as Jesus broke the bread of life in a diverse community seeking wholeness and abundance for all, so should we break bread for others, giving ourselves in remembrance of Christ. And as Jesus lifted the cup of grace, seeking to offer mercy and acceptance to all, so should we, through Christ, pass the cup of grace as we forgive ourselves and others for our deep transgressions. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and juice. May they be for us the body of Christ, that we may be for the wounded, for the isolated, for the oppressed, for the poor, for the vulnerable, for the outcast, and for all the world, the body of Christ redeemed by your love. Make us one with each other and one in ministry to all the world through your Son, Jesus Christ. With the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Friends, the body of Christ, broken for you. And the cup of grace poured out for you. Thanks be to God for this table of grace. Amen.
As you go throughout your week, it's really likely that you're going to experience times where you feel glad, where you feel mad, where you may be sad. You're going to have things happen that are good and things that you perceive to be bad. This is what Ecclesiastes tells us it means to have a full life. My prayer for you is that as you move through each of those feelings and seasons, that you find your body and your soul nourished with good food and good company around the table. To the one who gives us life and breath and food and joy, thanks be to God. Amen.
You promised till the day you call us home. become a mountain we stand on.
Let our faith become a mountain that will rise and never.